morning, everyone. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you for your gracious introduction. I try to keep it simple. Donna Brazile is 50 years old. She's worked on 7 presidential campaigns, 59 congressional campaigns, 17 state and local campaigns for Barack Obama. She traveled to 48 states, 2 more states. She would have become Miss USA without the bikini. You get the picture. Let me tell you, I got home last night at 3 o'clock a.m. Ever since we elected our first black president, I've been working long hours, extended hours. But there have been some challenging hours, as you can imagine. One of the hardest jobs I have, and I have many jobs, I wear many hats, no wigs, thank you, is to try to not only give out the facts so that you, the American people, can form your opinions, but also I know that when I'm called upon, as I was last night, to first appear on CNN in the pregame, pre-inaugural address, and then ABC in the postgame, a post-inaugural address, NPR in the post-analysis, and then, of course, several other radio stations across the country. As you look at the time zone, you just keep going until it's 12 o'clock somewhere, and then it's finally say clear, and you're like, okay, what do I do now? Well, for me, I said I'm gonna take just a few hours rest because I knew this morning that I would come to Howard University. I love this institution. I saw Dr. Thank you. I saw Dr. Lorenzo Morris when I drove up, and he was trying to tell me where to go. And I said, you remember, I was a kid back when you didn't have to give me directions. I know where to go. And it just reminded me of the first visit I made here when I moved to Washington, D.C. soon after graduating from college. I had a job, and Dr. Thornton, I call him Alvin, but Dr. Thornton and I, back in the day when, before people took polls and sort of recruited people, we joined up. We answered the call. This was a moment that we believed that the time was ripe to make that final push to make Dr. King's birthday a national holiday. We didn't have a lot of funds, resources, but we believed in his dream, we believed ultimately in his calling, and it was here at Howard University where we recruited many of our first activists, our organizers. This was a fertile place to come and find some organizers willing to give of their time. We didn't have money. We had no money. Despite all of the celebrity endorsements and Stevie Wonder's hit song, Happy Birthday, we had hardly any money, but we had so many of your classmates, your wonderful student body with us. The first to endorse, the first to send out letters to other historical black colleges and universities, and the first to be recruited to serve as marshals each and every winter as we pull the coalition together to march to demand his birthday. So it is indeed an honor to be here in the month of January to once again recruit you for another cause. Because there's another calling that you must answer. And that is to serve at this difficult hour in our nation, to not only stand up and represent the best of your generation, but to answer the call of your president, Barack Obama, to serve this country at a time of challenge and to be able to make a difference. I hope you know that 20 years from now, when you're standing up here, you won't be quite 50 yet. You'll be close to it, trust me. It goes by like that. You will be able to look back and say, we marched to the voting booth in November of 2008, and we changed history. It was your generation that made it happen. I know. I've been involved in enough campaigns to know when young people stand up, you often make a difference. This country had already decided to go forward. He was where history was taking us. And now you must be prepared. You must be prepared to go even further than just voting for change. You must be prepared to do battle for change. And it is a battle that is now being waged on whether or not we move forward or we go back. I'm delighted to be back on your campus. And Dr. Harris, you might not know this, but I remember you too. I remember all of you because you were my mentors. Though I didn't attend this great institution, this Mecca, this top research institution, I know of your history and I know of your journey, your story, and of course, your bright future. But it's academics like Dr. Harris who really gave me the strength, not just to be an organizer, but also to write about what was happening, what was transcendent at the moment. So I thank you for your leadership and your scholarship and your wonderful book on the nation's capital that I recall when I worked for Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton as her chief of staff during the decade of the 90s. And so there's a lot of anxiety today across the country. And voters, as we all know, they're impatient. They are worried. But the president inherited a colossal mess. And fixing the mess in 12 months, quite honestly, is not realistic. The truth is, the president understands the anger that the voters feel. And he's taken on all of the challenges. Whether it's popular or not, he's going to have to clean up the mess. Everything he inherited from two expensive wars to an economy on the brink of collapse was marked urgent when he stepped into the Oval Office. And there's no one, in my judgment, who understands, perhaps like Barack Obama, that the cards are stacked against him. The wind is blowing at his face and not at his back. History suggests that this is going to be a difficult year for the president because it's an election year. But as President Obama stated last evening, this is no time to run to the hills. I'm sure there are a bunch of undisclosed locations up there. Dick Cheney's probably still there too. This is no time to lack the will or the spine to deliver on the promises made to the American people. And it's no time to sit on the sidelines simply because so many of his opponents simply want him to fail.